Hello, welcome to Financial Insider Weekly. I'm your host, Michael Gray, CPA. My guest today is Scott Hazlett, and Scott is a California attorney and CPA who practices in the areas of taxation, real estate, estate planning, financial problem resolution, and 1031 exchanges. He's a certified specialist in taxation law, California State Bar Board of Legal Specialization. He's also a qualified intermediary for tax-deferred exchanges. Scott previously worked with Price Waterhouse and was an investment executive with Merrill Lynch. He graduated from Taft University School of Law in 1996 and set up his own law firm. He is a past president of the East Bay chapter of California Society of CPAs, and Scott also teaches a lot of continuing education classes for CPAs about real estate. And he's involved in the planning committee for a real estate conference that's going to be coming up next month. Quite knowledgeable in the area of real estate. In a past life, he was a sports writer covering Major League Baseball, National Football League, and other sports. Scott, thanks for joining me today.
Thanks for having me.
Today, Scott and I are going to be talking about tax-deferred 1031 exchanges of real estate. And this is actually quite an involved subject. We're going to just hit a few highlights to try to bring a few things to your attention, but mostly to encourage you to see your own tax advisor and make sure that you get help with this, because this is, as you'll see, I think, not a do-it-yourself project. So let's get on with our subject here. First of all, Scott, you're a qualified intermediary. Are people doing these tax-deferred exchanges of real estate right now?
It's very, very active, very active. We had, if you look back in recent times over the past decade, there was a time in the early 2000s when many, many transactions were happening. And then we had our meltdown in 2008, 2009, so all the gains went away.
Uh-huh.
This is gain-driven, so I want to sell my property and I have a tax gain.
Right.
Well, if you have no gain, you have no need for this. And of course, now the economy has rebounded, and property, and especially in San Francisco Bay Area, South Bay, et cetera, very hot, property values are escalating. So anybody who wants to sell property that is an investment property or a business property, they've got to consider this as a possibility to avoid what otherwise is very punitive taxes.
Right, okay. So what is a 1031 exchange?
A 1031 is a code section of the federal tax code. So, that's just arbitrary.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you might hear somebody call them tax-free exchanges,
yeah,
or tax-deferred exchanges, or Starker. That was an early case, Starker
mm-hmm.
exchange and so forth. What it really boils down to is the code allows that if you exchange one property, called the relinquished property, give up the relinquished property, and you acquire a replacement property in an exchange, you will not recognize gain on the disposition of the relinquished property. That's sort of it in a substance. Both properties have to be so-called held for investment as required by the code, which is somewhat murky in some cases, or used in an active trade or business. The word exchange in the statute, the requirement of exchange, is very interesting because in modern practice, based on some old case law and then some code changes that happened in 1984, we now basically don't really have exchanges, but what we have is this concept of typically a sale in one independent escrow transaction followed by a purchase a different day, different party, and so forth. So you don't, the old days, the old thinking of, I've got to find somebody who wants my property, who has property that I want to do a trade. That's all passé. Now you can simply sell and then go out and buy something else. And through this concept of the qualified intermediary and some regulations around it, you can get the benefits of avoiding the current tax on the sale of the relinquished property.
Right. And so the idea, though, is that when you sell that property, you have to have made an arrangement for somebody to hold the funds for you who is the intermediary.
Correct.
And so so you don't want to touch the funds
right,
that are coming out from the sale leg of this deal.
Yeah, so two examples on that. So I'm in that business and I get a lot of calls. I get referrals from you and mm-hmm. many other CPAs and mm-hmm. real estate agents and so forth. So a taxpayer will call up and say, we want to do an exchange. We want to sell property X and we don't even know what we want to buy yet. Mm-hmm. And I say, well, when are you closing? And they say, well, we're closing on October 15th. And today is September, whatever it is, 22nd. Okay, that's fine. So we formulate some papers that are exchange agreement and so where they're called out in the regulations. We follow a regulatory pattern that's been approved by the IRS. And the upshot of it is when the closing transaction happens, if the taxpayer gets the money, it's a taxable event. It's a big tax disaster. On the other hand, if the escrow follows these exchange instructions and so forth, the money goes to us and is held in a trust account and earmarked specifically for the purchase of a replacement property, either to be determined or previously determined.
Okay. So for real estate, what's like kind?
Yeah, so the code requires that the property, the relinquished property, and the replacement property be like kind. Extremely broad. Apartment building is like kind to a warehouse. A warehouse is like kind to a 30-year lease on an airport. You know, it can be, as long as there's real estate component, it can be very broad. Single family house for multifamily, single family for office building for a strip center. So it's very, very broad.
Yeah. So for real estate, it's actually quite, it's just about anything,
correct.
You know, as long as it's real estate.
Correct.
And where there are other types of personal property that, personal property, for example, equipment and so forth, that has to be more similar.
Yeah, an earth mover is not like kind to a copy machine.
There you go. So can a 1031 exchange result in taxable income?
Absolutely can. There's a concept called boot.
Mm-hmm.
Which is probably a question on your list.
Mm-hmm.
It's possible. Let me just illustrate the point with an example. So you sell a property for 100, and let's say what's called the basis. You paid 20 for it, and that's called the basis. So in computing the gain, it's 100 minus 20 equals 80. So that's the gain. And if you just sell it, then you got 80 gain, and there's a tax rate. Is it long-term, short-term? Is it depreciation? There's a variety of things. But it's taxable income, effectively taxable gain.
Mm-hmm.
If you buy the next property in a valid exchange going through all the protocols that I've described, and the purchase price is 100, then or higher, then you're going to shift all of the gain and defer it, basically avoid it currently. However, if you buy a property for, say, 70, so you've gone from here to here and you've got a 30 difference, the difference is called boot. It's receipt, most likely it's a receipt of money.
Mm-hmm.
If I collect 100 over here and I only reinvest 70 over here, I don't get to keep the 30 as the intermediary, I have to give it back to the taxpayer. So the taxpayer has received 30.
Mm-hmm.
And so effectively they've deferred some of their gain and they've had recognition on this so-called boot, this non-like-kind property is what it really amounts to.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So this is a little technical. What is a deferred exchange and what is a simultaneous exchange?
That's not too technical at all. We've talked about deferred exchanges. That's the most common thing.
Uh-huh.
Deferred exchange is closing a sale today. So that's the closing date and the money goes to me and I hold it for you. And then tomorrow or later, within 180 days, you will buy a replacement property using the money that I'm holding and other financing. That's deferred in this time sense that it's not non-simultaneous, sometimes it's called. Simultaneous exchange, a most common example I can give you is a business car. So you use your car 100% for business because you're a taxi driver. You go down to the dealer and you say, this has got about 5 million miles on it. I'm trading it in. So you give them the car. They give you a few bucks credit. You get a new car and you give them a loan or you give them money. That's a 1031 exchange. That's a simultaneous exchange, simultaneous trade.
And so, and in the old days, most of these real estate deals were actually put together simultaneously. You'd see them all on a big escrow.
And they're big escrow. There's a triangular exchange and there's the Alderson method and the Baird method. And all that's nonsense now, really.
Okay. What is a reverse exchange?
Good question. A reverse exchange allows the taxpayer to actually acquire the replacement property before selling the relinquished property. So let's say today you're on the marketplace, and as we know, today, as of right now, today's September 22nd, very much a seller's market. Mm-hmm. Very hard to buy property because everybody wants way too much, and there's a lot of buyers and there's a lot of money chasing. So somehow, you know, blind squirrel finds the nut. you come across this property that's absolutely ideal. And the owner says, yeah, it's for sale, and we're going to have our bidding tomorrow, and then we're going to select the winner the next day, and we're going to close in 10 days. And you say, wow, that's really great. It's $1 million, or it's $2 million, or whatever it is. So you say, I'd love to sell this property over here, but I can't do that in 10 days. Well, there's a method that's approved by the IRS that allows you to buy this, as long as you have the money. That's the biggest challenge. You have the money, either financing or something, and you buy this and you park it with a guy like me. So I hold it for you, and while you're over here marketing this one, and then within 180 days, if you sell this, I give you this and you get an exchange. But that's done in a reverse fashion, and it was approved about 15 years ago by the IRS.
Okay.
And there's other variations on a theme, but that gives you the gist of it.
Right. So it's like, it's structured more or less, as I understand it, that you're making a loan to the intermediary.
Correct.
Who uses the funds then to buy the property.
That's correct.
Hold the title for you.
That's correct.
Okay. So what are the requirements for identifying a replacement property?
So in 1984, the law was changed to add the requirements of the so-called 45-day identification period in 180 days. And as a bit of trivia, the way the statute was written at first, it was actually 44 days.
Oh, okay.
but that was changed the following year in some corrections.
Okay.
So now you have to, you have 45 days to identify it. So if you close today, today's September 22nd, I believe it's November 5th, let's see, is there eight days this month, 31, 9, is it the 5th or the 6th? 6th of November, I think. So on that 6th of November, let's say, the 45th day, mm-hmm. the taxpayer has to write a letter postmarked to that day. It's like the old tax filing. Postmark the letter. Included in there are forms that say, I hereby identify property 1, property 2, property 3 as my potential replacement property with respect to my property that I gave up or property that I sold. So that in essence is how identification works.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. And then how much time do we have to finish this whole thing up?
Okay, so the 84 Act also put in the 180-day requirement. The 45 days and the 180 days run at the same time. And I can't do the math that quick. We're on TV. I'm really nervous.
Don't worry.
So 180 days from today, I believe, is, let's see, September. So I'm going to call it March 17th, March 18th, something along those lines.
Yeah, yeah.
That's the outside date for closing. And there's an exception to that rule. If you're, for example, a calendar year taxpayer and you close after October 16th, you have to get an extension on your income tax return to get the full 180 days. Otherwise, that's shortened to the tax return deadline. And of course, the extension is automatic, so there's not really a threat. You just have to do it.
Right. So it's very important when you have one of these exchanges and it falls in that period to get that extension. The other thing, though, is that 180 days can go awfully fast.
Well, 45 days goes.
45 days even faster.
That goes even faster. So the as a practical matter, let me just tell you that the typical, not a typical, but many times you hear this. So I get a call, hi, I want to do an exchange. Will you help me? Yes, I can be your intermediary, and I describe the process. A lot of the same things we're talking about. When is your closing? Tomorrow. Okay, that's fine. And we get the paperwork going, and we fire it in there. Email is great. You know, all the technology is great. So we get it in there. The exchange is going. And then my next question, just in curiosity, have you found a replacement property? No. Do you have a real estate agent? No. We're thinking about starting to look next week. I said, really? I can't believe this. And for those people, if they succeed in finding something, the amazing thing is that it's usually a lateral move. They usually buy something that they sold, and that really doesn't accomplish anything except the real estate agent gets money, and the Prop 13 assessment goes up, you know. Because so, word of the wise, the day you decide to sell, even before you call the real estate agent to list the property for sale, that's the day you start looking.
I had a client that was an active real estate investor years ago, and he told me, he says, I never sell a property unless I've already identified a property that I want to buy.
Correct.
Yeah. So.
And this is where this reverse thing comes into play, yeah. Because if you have the bucks, frankly, if mm-hmm. you have this financial capability, you buy the other property and you know what you're selling, so automatically you've eliminated the 45-day problem,
yeah.
with some additional expense and so forth. But it's really, it's very spooky to get down to the day 43 and you really are sort of on the bubble and
yeah.
so forth. So.
Yeah, and I've heard of some cases where these deals have almost fallen apart or whatever, that suddenly there's a negotiation that happens because you're getting close to the 180 days and the seller knows that he's got you.
That or if you identify properties and day 45 passes, mm-hmm. there's no substitutions,
yeah.
there's no replacements, there's no extensions. So you've named three, and those are the only three in the whole country that you can buy. And if the seller knows it, and the seller knows the other two have sold to the other buyers, you're the last shot in the gun. They're not going to give you a credit.
Yeah.
They're not going to concede.
Not a good deal. Suddenly it's, oh yeah, by the way, I need an extra blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, right.
So why don't you talk about what is the role of the qualified intermediary?
So in 91, the IRS issued regulations under 1031 that sort of follow the statute. And the original straw man, if you will, was the Crown Corporation for the Starker case that occurred mm-hmm. back in the 60s. So carved into the regulations is this concept of a qualified intermediary, and simply a party, a third party, that holds the sales proceeds said to be beyond the actual or constructive receipt of the taxpayer. So the property sells, the title company sends the money to me, I hold it. I'm going to hold it in general for 180 days, The only time I'm going to disperse it is in respect of purchasing or depositing on a replacement property. But if you call me up and say I need to buy a car or I need a few bucks for my college tuition or whatever, the rules prohibit me from doing that. And that's the idea that the money really, you never get the cash and you never control the cash. And the idea is that if you don't control the cash in any way, then you don't really have receipt and you don't have a sale. That's kind of the idea. So it's a well-fashioned regulatory scheme that the IRS actually has approved.
Okay. Is there any risk when you choose an intermediary?
Yeah, so that's the big question. I get asked that a lot. So, and actually in the past there have been thieves and just incompetence. Land America, which is now out of business, or maybe they're part of somebody else, a huge title company, I think New York based or something, they were basically commingling all of the, or a good bit of the exchange money. So money would go to them to hold, and they would deliver it when you specified. Mm-hmm. But then something happened with their finances, they filed bankruptcy, and their money was gone and so forth. So that's an issue, that's definitely an issue. The other flavor of that is you have an intermediary, and they just are crooks. They get your money, they steal it. Okay, so in response to that, the state of California adopted some new rules in the financial code that require one of two things for an intermediary account. Your choice, one of two things. The account, or the person holding the account, which is usually a corporation, we have a corporation, and our corporation could get a bond. So we buy a bond and it protects, so if the money gets stolen, it's effectively a fidelity bond. The alternative approach, which we use, is a dual signature bank account. So money goes into our bank. We actually use a bank that's headquartered in San Jose, so you'd be happy to know that.
Okay.
and so our bank holds the account, and there's an account agreement among the bank, us as the intermediary, and the taxpayer. And the agreement says basically, the bank shall not disperse money unless they get signature from me and from taxpayer on the same piece of paper describing the payee and the wire instructions. And the wire instructions will typically be XYZ title company for the next escrow. Mm-hmm. So that's a protective device.
Okay. Can an intermediary provide tax advice?
No. The qualified intermediary, well, yes and no. Let's put it that way. Yes and no. When you read the rules, the regulations have a concept called the disqualified intermediary. Mm-hmm. So the rules are written something like this. Anybody can be your intermediary. But if you want to fall into a safe harbor where you know the IRS can't challenge this, you hire what's called a qualified intermediary. And the qualified intermediary is independent of you. And the regulations describe independent being it's not your broker or your banker or your tax advisor or your lawyer, and there's a few other things. Okay, and that's usually described as, did the accountant, lawyer, banker, broker, did they do business with you in the last 2 years ending on the date of the sale? Mm-hmm. So if you, and you're probably asked this from time to time, can you be my intermediary? And you say, no, I've done your taxes forever, certainly within the last 2 years. So as a result, you're disqualified from being the intermediary. Now, you could still be the intermediary, but if challenged, it's a real dumb idea because it might blow up in everybody's face. So therefore, you go to a qualified intermediary, and this is usually an entity which doesn't have any of these prior stigmas of being the accountant, the lawyer, and the banker, and so forth. So the qualified intermediary. Now the question is, can that give advice? Well, this is a corporation. It's typically not a lawyer or law firm. It's typically mm-hmm. not an accounting firm. It's typically just a general purpose corporation. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't really have a license to give those types of advice, okay? Mm-hmm. Now in practice, the title companies have their affiliates, and certainly I'm an affiliate, if you will, of my own company. I'm gonna give some general advice. If somebody calls me up, I'm gonna identify stuff. I'm gonna say, look, this could be a problem, but I'm also gonna try to get the accountant on board to try to huddle on this thing and see if what, because ultimately, the worst I could do for you is, because you're a colleague too, I mean, I'm a CPA and I do taxes, so I sort of approve something, and then next summer you get it because they're on extension and you're doing the taxes and you read it and you say, I don't agree, that's not kosher. Mm-hmm. So that's sort of, you give advice, but you give mostly caution. Mm-hmm. You know, kind of thing. So
yeah, well, obviously you're going to give some instructions because you're probably the one who's providing the forms and the other stuff. You got to sign here, and we got to.
Well, certainly the administrative aspect of it as well.
Yeah. Can a property owner exchange down to eliminate debt?
So real quick example. So that 100 property has a 40 mortgage on it. So some people are they get the concepts misconstrued. So they sell and they get net 60. I hold it, and then they say, I want to buy something for 60 over here, all cash. And I didn't get any money. So they bought here for 100, or sold here for 100, bought for 60, and we still have that delta in there, that 40. That's a boot, even though the boot is characterized by going out of debt by 40 in that example. Mm-hmm. So word of the wise, there's a concept called the napkin test, which is an easy way. The main thing is, remember, buy at a price equal or greater than what you sell for.
Okay. So we have a few minutes left. There's some new California reporting requirements that I want to at least mention in our interview. So maybe you can talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, so what's happened? The legislature figured out that gains are leaving California. So let me just paint an example. So, and I'm sure you've heard this before as a practitioner, I'm so sick and tired of Jerry Brown, Gray Davis, Arnold, whoever is the bad guy for all the taxes in California. So I'm moving to Wyoming tax-free, I'm moving to Nevada, I'm moving to Florida, and I'm taking my real estate with me. So I live in San Jose, I have a fourplex in San Jose and a home in San Jose. So I buy a house in Reno and I sell my house in San Jose that I live in, and then I sell my fourplex in San Jose, and I do a 1031 exchange into a much larger building because of the values. So I've deferred my taxes, and California also is conformed with the federal, so there's a deferral. What was happening before 2014, what was happening was people would move away and then they would stop filing in California because they didn't live here anymore. But in fact, there's latent gains in the Nevada property in this example. So Franchise Tax Board was getting cheated, at least they felt. So when that thing would ultimately sell, there is a gain associated with the San Jose property translated to Reno, and So what do we do about that? Now, that person who does all this stuff, moves completely out and no longer has a California filing requirement, has to file annually with California saying, I still have my rental property in Reno. The gain has not been triggered yet, but as soon as it is, I'll give you a shout. And then the year it sells, that person has to file a California return and show the gain that was triggered that was long ago earned in San Jose.
Right. So this is an annual filing requirement. And I believe it also applies to California residents when they exchange for a property that's out of state.
Yes, except for the fact that the those people, there is a disclosure requirement, but those people are filing anyway.
They're going to be filing anyway, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's not going to be top of mind for the people who are going out of state.
Correct.
So anyway, so I just wanted to warn people about that. And again, this is going to be something that's awfully easy to miss. And if you don't, you'll get a nice friendly letter from the IRS asking, not the IRS, from the Franchise Tax Board asking you to send a check.
Correct.
And trying to tax the gains currently. So it's not something that you want to miss and mess around with. So suddenly your life has become much more complicated from this thing of moving out of state. Folks, we're really out of time. So I hope that we've brought some good points to your attention and that you'll go and get some good tax advice. We'll see you next time on Financial Insider Weekly.